This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Lyndon Baines Johnson served as the 36th President of the United States from 1963 to 1969. Johnson assumed the office after serving as the 37th Vice President of the United States under President John F. Kennedy, who was assassinated in 1963. Johnson was a Democrat from Texas who had previously served as Senate Majority Leader after succeeding Kennedy. Johnson ran for a full term in the 1964 election, winning by a landslide over Republican opponent Arizona Senator Barry Goldwater. Johnson's presidency marked the high tide of modern liberalism in the United States, as Johnson expanded upon the New Deal with the Great Society. Johnson's Great Society created Medicare and Medicaid, defended civil rights, and promoted federal spending on education, the arts, urban and rural development, public services, and a war on poverty, assisted in part by a growing economy. The war on poverty helped millions of Americans rise above the poverty line during Johnson's presidency. Civil rights bills signed by Johnson banned racial discrimination in voting, public facilities, housing, and the workplace. With the passage of the Immigration and Nationality Act of 1965, the country's immigration system was reformed and all racial origin quotas were removed, replaced by national origin quotas. Johnson's popularity waned as other issues came to the fore. Johnson pursued a policy of containment in Vietnam, hoping to stop the spread of communism into Southeast Asia. During the Cold War, the number of American military personnel in Vietnam increased dramatically, from 16,000 advisors in non-combat roles in 1963, to 550,000 in early 1968, many in combat roles. Growing unease with the war stimulated a large, angry anti-war movement based especially on university campuses in the U.S. and abroad. Johnson faced further troubles when summer riots broke out in most major cities after 1965, and crime rates soared, as his opponents raised demands for law and order policies. While he began his presidency with widespread approval, support for Johnson declined as the public became upset with both the war and the growing violence at home. The Democratic Party factionalized as anti-war elements denounced Johnson, and Johnson ended his bid for renomination after a disappointing finish in the New Hampshire primary. Contents: 1. Major acts as president, 2. Succession, 3. Personnel, 31. Administration and cabinet, 32. Judicial appointments, 3. 21. Supreme Court, 3. 22. Other courts, 4. Domestic policy, 41. Taxation, 42. Civil rights, 421. Civil Rights Act of 1964, 422. Voting Rights Act, 423. 1968. Civil Rights Act, 43. War on Poverty, 44. Federal funding for education, 45. Healthcare reform, 46. Immigration, 47. Transportation, 48. Gun control, 49. Space program, 410. Urban riots, 5. Foreign policy, 51. Vietnam, 511. Gulf of Tonkin Resolution, 5. 512-1964-513-1965-514-1965-515-1967-516-1968-52 Soviet Union, 53. The Six-Day War and Israel, 54. Intervention in the Dominican Republic, 55. List of international trips, 6. Elections, 61. 1964 Presidential election, 62. 1966 Mid-term election, 63. 1968 Presidential election, 7. Legacy and evaluation, 8. See also. 9. References. Major acts as President. Domestic policy actions. War on Poverty. Economic Opportunity Act of 1964. Food Stamp Act of 1964. Social Security Amendments of 1965. Housing and Urban Development Act of 1965. Civil Rights. Civil Rights Act of 1964. Voting Rights Act of 1965. Age Discrimination in Employment Act. Civil Rights Act of 1968. Environmental Policy. Clean Air Act of 1963. National Emissions Standards Act. Wilderness Act. Education Policy. Elementary and Secondary Education Act. Higher Education Act of 1965. Public Health. Cigarette Labeling and Advertising Act. National Traffic and Motor Vehicle Safety Act. Gun Control Act of 1968. Culture. National Foundation on the Arts and the Humanities Act of 1965. National Historic Preservation Act of 1966. Public Broadcasting Act of 1967. Other Initiatives. Revenue Act of 1964. Immigration and Nationality Act of 1965. Truth in Lending Act. Foreign Policy Actions. Vietnam War. Joint Warfare in South Vietnam. Gulf of Tonkin Resolution. Operation Rolling Thunder. Intervention in the Dominican Civil War. Outer Space Treaty. Foreign Foreign Military Sales Act of 1968 Treaty on the Non-Proliferation of Nuclear Weapons. Supreme Court nominations Abe Fortas Thurgood Marshall Abe Fortas elevation to Chief Justice, not confirmed Homer Thornberry not confirmed succession main article, first inauguration of Lyndon B. Johnson Johnson being sworn in on Air Force One by Judge Sarah Hughes as Mrs. Johnson and Mrs. Kennedy look on President John F. Kennedy, in office since 1961, was assassinated in Dallas, Texas on November 22, 1963 Johnson was sworn in as President on the Air Force One plane in Dallas just 2 hours and 8 minutes after Kennedy's assassination Johnson was sworn in by U.S. District Judge Sarah T. Hughes, a family friend in the rush, a Bible was not at hand, so Johnson took the oath of office using a Roman Catholic missal from President Kennedy's desk Cecil Stoughton's iconic photograph of Johnson taking the presidential oath of office as Mrs. Kennedy looks on as the most famous photo ever taken aboard a presidential aircraft Johnson was convinced of the need to make an immediate transition of power after the assassination to provide stability to a grieving nation in shock he and the Secret Service were. Concerned that he could also be a target of a conspiracy, and felt compelled to rapidly return to Washington, D.C. Johnson's rush was greeted by some with assertions that Johnson was in too much haste to assume power in the days following the assassination. Lyndon B. Johnson made an address to Congress, saying that no memorial oration or eulogy could more eloquently honor President Kennedy's memory than the earliest possible passage of the Civil Rights Bill for which he fought so long. The wave of national grief following the assassination gave enormous momentum to Johnson's promise to carry out Kennedy's plans and his policy of seizing Kennedy's legacy to give momentum to his legislative agenda on November 29, 1963 just 1 week after Kennedy's assassination. Johnson issued an executive order to rename NASA's Apollo Launch Operations Center and the NASA, Air Force Cape Canaveral Launch Facilities as the John F. Kennedy Space Center. Johnson was alert to the public demand for answers to head off snowballing speculation about such conspiracies, he immediately created a panel headed by Chief Justice Earl Warren, known as the Warren Commission, to investigate Kennedy's assassination. The commission conducted extensive research and hearings and unanimously concluded that Lee Harvey Oswald acted alone in the assassination. Conspiracy theorists were not satisfied and formulated numerous theories which continue to circulate. Personnel Johnson retained senior Kennedy appointees, some for the full term of his presidency. Robert Kennedy, brother of the former president, stayed on as Attorney General despite a notoriously difficult relationship between Johnson and the Attorney General. Kennedy remained in office for a few months until leaving in 1964 to successfully run for the Senate. Although Johnson had no official chief of staff, Walter Jenkins was the first among a handful of equals and presided over the details of daily operations at the White House. George Reedy, who was Johnson's second longest-serving aide, assumed the post of press secretary when John F. Kennedy's own Pierre Salinger left that post in March 1964. Horace Busby was another triple-threat man. As Johnson referred to his aides, he served primarily as a speech writer and political analyst. Bill Moyers was the youngest member of Johnson's staff. He handled scheduling and speechwriting part-time. Johnson had no vice president during his first term, as the Constitution lacked a mechanism for choosing a replacement vice president until the ratification of the 25th Amendment in 1967. Johnson selected Senator Hubert Humphrey of Minnesota as his running mate for the 1964 election after Humphrey helped pass the Civil Rights Act of 1964 through the Senate, and Humphrey served as vice president during Johnson's second term. Johnson created two new cabinet posts during his presidency. The Secretary of Housing and Urban Development and the Secretary of Transportation joined the cabinet in 1965 and 1966. Respectively, Administration and Cabinet Vice President Hubert Humphrey. The Johnson Cabinet Office named term President Lyndon B. Johnson 1963-1969, Vice President Nunn 1963-1965, Hubert Humphrey 1965-1969, Secretary of State Dean Rusk 1963-1969. Secretary of Treasury C. Douglas Dillon 1963-1965, Henry H. Fowler 1965-1968, Joseph W. Barr 1968-1969, Secretary of Defense Robert McNamara 1963-1968, Clark M. Clifford 1968-1969, Attorney General Robert F. Kennedy 1963-1964, Nicholas Katzenbach 1964-1966, Ramsey Clark. 1966-1969 Postmaster General John A. Gronewski 1963-1965 Larry O'Brien 1965-1968 W. Marvin Watson 1968-1969 Secretary of the Interior Stuart Lee Udall 1963-1969 Secretary of Agriculture Orville Lothrop Freeman 1963-1969 Secretary of Commerce Luther Hartwell Hodges 1963-1965 John Thomas Connor. 1965-1967 Alexander Buell Trowbridge 1967-1968 Cyrus Rollett Smith 1968-1969 Secretary of Labor W. Willard Wirtz 1963-1969 Secretary of Health, Education, and Welfare Anthony Celebrez 1963-1965 John William Gardner 1965-1968 Wilbur Joseph Cohen 1968-1969 Secretary of Housing and Urban Development. Robert Clifton Weaver 1966-1968 Robert Coldwell Wood 1969, Secretary of Transportation Alan Stevenson Boyd 1967-1969 Judicial appointments see also, Lyndon B. Johnson Judicial appointment controversies with the appointment of Thurgood Marshall, Johnson placed the first African American on the Supreme Court Supreme Court main article, Lyndon B. Johnson Supreme Court candidates Johnson appointed the following justices to the Supreme Court of the United States, Abe Fortas. Information Johnson chose to appoint Abe Fortas to the Supreme Court in hopes of filling this role, and Johnson created an opening on the court by convincing Associate Justice Arthur Goldberg to become United States Ambassador to the United Nations in 1967. Johnson successfully nominated Thurgood Marshall to succeed the retiring Tom C. Clark on the court. Marshall became the first African American to serve on the Supreme Court. Clark retired from the Supreme Court after Johnson appointed his son, Ramsey Clark, as Attorney General. When Earl Warren announced his retirement in 1968, Johnson nominated Fortas to succeed him as Chief Justice of the United States, and nominated Homer Thornberry to succeed Fortas as Associate Justice. However, Fortas's nomination was defeated by senators opposed to Fortas's liberal views and close association with President Johnson. President Richard Nixon instead appointed Warren's replacement in 1969. Other courts main article, Lyndon B. Johnson judicial appointments. In addition to his Supreme Court appointments, Johnson appointed 40 judges to the United States Courts of Appeals, and 126 judges to the United States District Courts. Johnson also had a small number of judicial appointment controversies, with one appellate and three district court nominees not being confirmed by the United States Senate before Johnson's presidency ended. Domestic policy. Though many liberals had been suspicious of Johnson during his congressional career, on taking office, Johnson sought to expand the government on a level comparable to the New Deal. Johnson wanted a catchy slogan for the 1964 campaign to describe his proposed domestic agenda. Eric Goldman, who joined the White House in December of that year, thought Johnson's domestic program was best captured in the title of Walter Lippmann's book The Good Society. Richard Goodwin tweaked it to The Great Society and incorporated this in detail as part of a speech for Johnson in May 1964 at the University of Michigan. It encompassed movements of urban renewal, modern transportation, clean environment, anti-poverty, healthcare reform, crime control, and educational reform. Taxation. Despite his previous role as Senate Majority Leader, Johnson had largely been sidelined in the Kennedy administration nonetheless. Upon taking office, Johnson decided to pursue many of Kennedy's domestic initiatives, which had largely failed to pass Congress. Johnson worked closely with Harry F. Byrd of Virginia to negotiate a reduction in the budget below $100 billion in exchange for what became overwhelming Senate approval of the Revenue Act of 1964, which provided a major tax cut. Congressional approval followed in late February and facilitated efforts to follow on civil rights. Johnson's Keynesian economic advisors hoped that the bill, which cut the top tax rate from 91% in 1963 to 70% in 1965, would strengthen the economy without causing inflation late into his first term in office. Johnson signed in law the Revenue and Expenditure Control Act of 1968, the second major tax bill, the product of months of negotiations. He reluctantly signed it to pay for the Vietnam War's mounting costs. The bill included a mix of tax increases and spending cuts. Civil Rights Act of 1964 main article. article, Civil Rights Act of 1964 meeting with civil rights leaders Rev. Martin Luther King Jr. left, Whitney Young, and James Farmer in the Oval Office in 1964 though a product of the South and a protege of segregationist Senator Richard Russell Jr., Johnson had long been personally sympathetic to the civil rights movement, and felt that the time had come to pass the first major civil rights bill since the Reconstruction era. President Kennedy had submitted a civil rights bill to Congress in June 1963, which was met with strong opposition. Kennedy's bill had already been approved by the House Judiciary Committee, but still faced opposition in the House Rules Committee, and the Senate historian Robert Caro notes that the bill Kennedy had submitted faced the same tactics that prevented the passage of civil rights bills in the past. Southern congressmen and senators used congressional procedure to prevent it from coming to a vote. In particular, they held up all of the major bills Kennedy had proposed and that were considered urgent, especially the tax reform bill, in order to force the bill's supporters to pull it on taking office. Johnson's first move was to pass the Revenue Act of 1964, which removed the leverage of Southern congressmen who had sought to trade support for the bill in exchange for the dropping of the civil rights measure. The chairman of the House Rules Committee, Howard Smith, was a segregationist who sought to kill the civil rights bill. Johnson decided on a campaign to use a discharge petition to force it onto the House floor, and he and his allies worked to persuade uncommitted Republicans and Democrats to support the petition, facing a growing threat that they would be bypassed. The House Rules Committee approved the bill and moved it to the floor of the full House, which passed it on February 10, 1964, by a vote of 290-110 before the bill's passage. Smith proposed an amendment that added protection from gender discrimination to the bill, in a sly attempt to prevent the bill's passage. However, Smith's maneuver backfired, as the House still voted to approve the bill. 152 Democrats and 136 Republicans voted in favor of it, while the majority of the opposition came from 88 Democrats representing states that had seceded during the Civil War. Johnson convinced Senate Majority Leader Mike Mansfield to put the House bill directly into consideration by the full Senate, bypassing the Senate Judiciary Committee and its segregationist chairman James Eastland, since the tax bill had already passed, and bottling up the bill in a committee was no longer an option. The anti-civil rights senators were left with the filibuster as their only remaining tool. Overcoming the filibuster required the support of over 20 Republicans, who were growing less supportive due to the fact that their party was about to nominate for president a candidate who opposed the bill. Senator Hubert Humphrey and Mansfield led the effort to pass it in the Senate, and one of their major tasks was to convince Senate Minority Leader Everett Dirksen and other Midwestern conservatives to support it. Johnson and the conservative Dirksen reached a compromise in which the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission's enforcement powers were weakened, but civil rights groups still supported the bill due to its end of de jure segregation. After months of debate, the Senate voted for closure in a 71-29 vote, narrowly clearing the 67-vote threshold then required to break filibusters. Though most of the opposition came from Southern Democrats, 1964 Republican presidential nominee Barry Goldwater, and five other Republicans also voted against the bill on June 19. The Senate voted to 73-27 in favor of the bill, sending it to the president. Johnson signed the Civil Rights Act of 1964 into law on July 2. Legend has it that, as he put down his pen, Johnson told an aide, "We have lost the South for a generation." Anticipating a coming backlash from Southern whites against Johnson's Democratic Party, the act banned segregation in public accommodations, banned employment gender discrimination, and strengthened the federal government's power to investigate racial and gender employment discrimination. The law, later upheld by the Supreme Court in cases such as Heart of Atlanta Motel, Inc. v. United States. Biographer Randall B. Woods has argued that Johnson effectively used appeals to Judeo-Christian ethics to garner support for the civil rights law. Woods writes that Johnson undermined the Southern filibuster against the bill. LBJ wrapped white America in a moral straitjacket. How could individuals who fervently, continuously, and overwhelmingly identified themselves with a merciful and just God continue to condone racial discrimination, police brutality, and segregation, where in the Judeo-Christian ethic was their justification for killing young girls in a church in Alabama, denying an equal education to black children, barring fathers and mothers from competing for jobs that would feed and clothe their families? Was Jim Crow to be America's response to godless communism? Voting Rights Act. Johnson began his elected presidential term with similar motives as he had upon succeeding to the office, ready to carry forward the plans and programs of John Fitzgerald Kennedy, not because of our sorrow or sympathy, but because they are right. He was reticent to push Southern congressmen even further after passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1964 and suspected their support may have been temporarily tapped out. Nevertheless, the Selma to Montgomery marches in Alabama led by Martin Luther King ultimately led Johnson to initiate debate on a voting rights bill in February 1965. The 15th Amendment had barred voting discrimination, but African Americans were still largely denied the right to vote through mechanisms, such as literacy tests and poll taxes. Johnson gave a congressional speech, Dalek considers it his greatest, in which he said, "Rarely at any time does an issue lay bare the secret heart of America itself, rarely are we met with the challenge, to the values and the purposes and the meaning of our beloved nation. The issue of equal rights for American Negroes is such an issue, and should we defeat every enemy, should we double our wealth and conquer the stars, and still be unequal to this issue, then we will have failed as a people and as a nation." In 1965, he achieved passage of the Voting Rights Act, which outlawed discrimination in voting, thus allowing millions of Southern blacks to vote for the first time in accordance with the Act. Several states, 7 of the 11 Southern states of the former Confederacy, Alabama, South Carolina, North Carolina, Georgia, Louisiana, Mississippi, Virginia, were subjected to the procedure of preclearance in 1965, while Texas, home to the majority of the African American population at the time, followed. In 1975, the Senate passed the Voting Rights Bill by a vote of 77-19 just after 2.5 months, and won passage in the House in July, by 333-85. The results were significant. Between the years of 1968 and 1980, the number of Southern black elected state and federal officeholders nearly doubled. The act also made a large difference in the numbers of black elected officials nationally. In 1965, a few hundred black office holders mushroomed to 6,000 in 1989. Perhaps most impressively, between 1964 and 1967, the voter registration rate of Mississippi African Americans rose from 67% to 598%. President Lyndon B. Johnson, Martin Luther King Jr., and Rosa Parks at the signing of the Voting Rights Act on August 6, 1965, after the murder of civil rights worker Viola Liuzzo. Johnson went on television to announce the arrest of 4 Ku Klux Klansmen implicated in her death. He angrily denounced the Klan as a hooded society of bigots, and warned them to return to a decent society before it's too late. Johnson was the first president to arrest and prosecute members of the Klan since Ulysses S. Grant about 93 years earlier. He turned to themes of Christian redemption to push for civil rights, thereby mobilizing support from churches north and south. At the Howard University commencement address on June 4, 1965, he said that both the government and the nation needed to help achieve goals, to shatter forever not only the barriers of law and public practice, but the walls which bound the condition of many by the color of his skin to dissolve, as best we can, the antique enmities of the heart which diminish the holder, divide the great democracy, and do wrong, great wrong, to the children of God. 1968 Civil Rights Act. Johnson expected to lose seats in the 1966 midterm elections, and chose to pursue a housing discrimination bill as his final major legislative goal of the 89th Congress. In April 1966, Johnson submitted a bill to Congress that barred owners from refusing to enter into agreements on the basis of race. The bill immediately garnered opposition from many of the Northerners who had supported the last two major civil rights bills. Though a version of the bill passed the House, it failed to win Senate approval, marking Johnson's first major legislative defeat. The law gained new impetus after the April 4, 1968 assassination of Martin Luther King. Being debated in the Senate, Johnson looked to further bolster his legislative record in advance of the 1964 election. While the previous two bills had been priorities of Kennedy, Johnson chose to next focus on the war on poverty based on the advice of economist Walter Heller. In April 1964, Johnson proposed the Economic Opportunity Act of 1964, which would create the Office of Economic Opportunity to oversee local community action agencies charged with dispensing aid to those in poverty. The act would also create the Job Corps, a work training program, and AmeriCorps Vista, a domestic version of the Peace Corps. Johnson was able to win the support of enough conservative Democrats to pass the bill, which he signed on August 20. Sergeant Shriver, a brother-in-law of John Kennedy, became the first head of the Office of Economic Opportunity. Johnson took an additional step in the war on poverty with an urban renewal effort, presenting to Congress in January 1966 the Demonstration Cities program. To be eligible, a city would need to demonstrate demonstrate its readiness to arrest blight and decay and make substantial impact on the development of its entire city. Johnson requested an investment of $400 million per year, totaling $24 billion. In the fall of 1966, the Congress passed a substantially reduced program costing $900 million, which Johnson later called the Model Cities Program. Changing the name had little effect on the success of the bill. The New York Times wrote 22 years later that the program was for the most part a failure. Federal funding for education. Johnson, whose own ticket out of poverty was a public education in Texas, fervently believed that education was a cure for ignorance and poverty, and was an essential component of the American dream, especially for minorities who endured poor facilities and tight-fisted budgets from local taxes in the 1960s. Education funding was especially tight due to the demographic challenges posed by the large baby boomer generation, but Congress had repeatedly rejected increased federal financing for public schools. Johnson made education the top priority of the Great Society agenda, with an emphasis on helping poor children after the 1964 landslide brought in many new liberal congressmen. LBJ launched a legislative effort which took the name of the Elementary and Secondary Education Act ESEA of 1965. The bill sought to double federal spending on education from $4 billion to $8 billion, with considerable facilitating by the White House. It passed the House by a vote of 263 to 153 on March 26, and then it remarkably passed without change in the Senate, by 73-8, without going through the usual conference committee. This was an historic accomplishment by the president, with the billion-dollar bill passing as introduced just 87 days before. For the first time, large amounts of federal money went to public schools. In practice, ESEA meant helping all public school districts, with more money going to districts that had large proportions of students from poor families. Johnson was able to pass the bill for a few reasons. The Civil Rights Act of 1964 made segregation in public schools a relative non-issue for the a pupil-centered approach to federal funding neutralized the divisive issue of funding parochial schools, and large Democratic majorities diluted the influence of many Republicans who tended to dislike teachers' unions. Johnson's second major education program was the Higher Education Act of 1965, which focused on funding for lower-income students, including grants, work-study money, and government loans. College graduation rates boomed after the passage of the act, with the percentage of college graduates tripling from 1964 to 2013. Johnson also signed a third important education bill in 1965, establishing the Head Start program to provide grants for preschools. Johnson created a new role for the federal government in supporting the arts, humanities, and public broadcasting. His administration set up the National Endowment for the Humanities and the National Endowment for the Arts, to support humanists and artists as the WPA once did in 1967. Johnson signed the Public Broadcasting Act to create educational television programs. The government had set aside radio bans for educational non-profits in the 1950s, and the Federal Communications Commission under President Kennedy had awarded the first federal grants to educational television stations, but Johnson sought to create a vibrant public television that would promote local diversity as well as educational programs. The legislation, which was based on the findings of the Carnegie Commission on Educational Television, created a decentralized network of public television stations. Healthcare reform. Main article, Social Security Amendments of 1965. Former President Truman and wife Bess at Medicare bill signing in 1965. As Lady Bird and Hubert Humphrey look on, former President Harry Truman had proposed a national health insurance system in 1945, and Johnson was heavily influenced by Truman's ideas since 1957. A group of Democrats had advocated for the government to cover the cost of hospital visits for seniors, who had seen higher health costs with the advent of new technologies such as antibiotics, but the American Medical Association and fiscal conservatives opposed a government role in health insurance. Johnson supported the passage of the King-Anderson Bill, which would establish a Medicare program for older patients administered by the Social Security Administration and financed by payroll taxes. Wilbur Mills, chairman of the Key House Ways and Means Committee, had long opposed such reforms, but the election of 1964 had defeated many allies of the AMA and shown that the public supported some version of public medical care. Mills suggested that Medicare be fashioned as a three-layer cake: hospital insurance under Social Security, a voluntary insurance program for doctor visits, and an expanded medical welfare program for the poor, known as Medicaid. The bill passed the House in April on 313-115 vote, and the Senate passed It's a more liberal version of the bill on July 9 after a conference committee session dominated by Mills. The House and Senate passed identical versions of the bill, and Johnson signed the bill on July 30, 1965. Johnson gave the first two Medicare cards to former President Truman and his wife Bess after signing the Medicare bill at the Truman Library in Independence, Missouri. Medicare and Medicaid now cover millions of Americans' immigration with the passage of the Sweeping Immigration and Nationality Act of 1965. The country's immigration system was reformed and all national origins quotas dating from the 1920s were removed. The percentage of foreign-born in the United States increased from 5% in 1965 to 14% in 2016. Scholars give Johnson little credit for the law, which was not one of his priorities. He had supported the restrictive McCarran-Walters Act of 1952 that was unpopular with reformers regardless. The Immigration and Nationality Act dramatically changed the ethnic composition of the United States, ending the national origins formula which had heavily favored European immigrants. The act also prioritized family reunification over the national origins of potential immigrants. Johnson also signed the Cuban Adjustment Act, which granted Cuban refugees an easier path to permanent residency and citizenship. Transportation in March 1965, Johnson sent to Congress a transportation message which included the creation of a new transportation department, which would include the Commerce Department's Office of Transportation, the Bureau of Public Roads, the Federal Aviation Agency, the Coast Guard, the Maritime Administration, the Civil Aeronautics Board, and the Interstate Commerce Commission. The bill passed the Senate after some negotiation over navigation projects. In the House, passage required negotiation over maritime interests, and the bill was signed October 15, 1965. Gun control. Following the assassinations of John F. Kennedy, Robert F. Kennedy, and Martin Luther King Jr., Johnson signed two major gun control laws in addition to the assassinations. Johnson's push for gun control was also motivated by mass shootings such as the one perpetrated by Charles Whitman. Johnson signed the Omnibus Crime Control and Safe Streets Act of 1968 shortly after Robert Kennedy's death on October 22, 1968. Lyndon Johnson signed the Gun Control Act of 1968, one of the largest and farthest-reaching federal gun control laws in American history. The measure prohibited convicted felons, drug users, and the mentally ill from purchasing handguns and raised record-keeping and licensing requirements. Johnson had sought to require the licensing of gun owners and the registration of all firearms, but could not convince Congress to pass a stronger bill. Space program. During Johnson's administration, NASA conducted the Gemini manned space program, developed the Saturn V rocket and its launch facility, and prepared to make the first manned Apollo program flights on January 27, 1967. The nation was stunned when the entire crew of Apollo 1 was killed in a cabin fire during a spacecraft test on the launch pad, stopping Apollo in its tracks rather than appointing another Warren-style commission. Johnson accepted Administrator James E. Webb's request for NASA to do its own investigation, holding itself accountable to Congress and the President. Johnson maintained his staunch support of Apollo through congressional and press controversy, and the program recovered the first two manned missions, Apollo 7 and the first manned flight to the Moon, Apollo 8, were completed by the end of Johnson's term. He congratulated the Apollo 8 crew, saying, "You've taken all of us, all over the world, into a new era." Less than a year after leaving office, Johnson attended the launch of Apollo 11, the first moon landing mission. Urban riots. Aftermath from a race riot in Washington, D.C., April 1968. Major riots in black neighborhoods caused a series of long hot summers. They started with a violent disturbance in the Harlem riots in 1964, and the Watts District of Los Angeles in 1965, and extended to 1971. The momentum for the advancement of civil rights came to a sudden halt in the summer of 1965, with the riots in Watts after 34 people were killed and $35 million in property was damaged. The public feared an expansion of the violence to other cities, and so the appetite for additional programs in LBJ's agenda was lost. Riots in 1967 in particular began to turn much of the public against the war on poverty, which became associated with urban policy despite much of its funding being devoted to rural areas. The biggest wave of riots came in April 1968 in over 100 cities after the assassination of Martin Luther King. Newark burned in 1967, where 6 days of rioting left 26 dead, 1,500 injured, and the inner city a burned-out without Shell in Detroit in 1967, Governor George Romney sent in 7,400 National Guard troops to quell fire bombings, looting, and attacks on businesses and on police. Johnson finally sent in federal troops with tanks and machine guns. Detroit continued to burn for three more days until finally 43 were dead, 2,250 were injured, 4,000 were arrested. Property damage ranged into the hundreds of millions. Johnson called for even more billions to be spent in the cities and another federal civil rights law regarding housing, but this fell on deaf ears. Johnson's popularity plummeted as a massive white political backlash took shape, reinforcing the sense Johnson had lost control of the streets of major cities as well as his party. Johnson created the Kerner Commission to study the problem of urban riots, headed by Illinois Governor Otto Kerner. According to Press Secretary George Christian, Johnson was unsurprised by the riots, saying, "What did you expect? I don't know why we're so surprised when you put your foot on a man's neck and hold him down for 300 years, and then you let him up. What's he going to do? He's going to knock your block off." Foreign policy. Vietnam. See also, Vietnam War. The Indochina Wars had been raging since the Japanese invasion of French Indochina during World War II, and France struggled to re-establish control over its former colonies after World War II. The communist Viet Minh successively opposed Japanese and French forces in Vietnam, and established a communist North Vietnam following the 1954 Geneva Agreements. The Vietnam War began in 1955 as North Vietnamese forces, with the support of the Soviet Union, China, and other communist governments, sought to reunify the country by taking control of South Vietnam. On taking office, Johnson made clear that he was not planning any major changes regarding the American role in Vietnam. At Kennedy's death, there were already 16,000 American military personnel in Vietnam, supporting the nominally democratic South Vietnamese government. However, Johnson's presidency ultimately saw a massive buildup of the American presence in Vietnam, with troop levels reaching a peak above 500,000 by the end of Johnson's tenure. Johnson subscribed to the domino theory, which speculated that the fall of one government to communism would lead to the fall of surrounding governments. Johnson thus adhered to the containment policy that required America to make a serious effort to stop all communist expansion. Johnson also feared that the fall of Vietnam would hurt Democratic credibility on national security issues and undermine Johnson's domestic initiatives, much as the loss of China and the Korean War hurt Democrats in the 1950s as American involvement in the war dragged on. The war became increasingly unpopular and a large anti-war movement arose. The Vietnam War would continue until 1975, well past the end of Johnson's time in office. Gulf of Tonkin Resolution. In August 1964, allegations arose from the military that two U.S. destroyers had been attacked by North Vietnamese torpedo boats in international waters 40 miles 64. U.S. goal remained the preservation of South Vietnamese independence through material and advice, as opposed to any U.S. offensive posture. The public's reaction to the resolution at the time was positive. 48% favored stronger measures in Vietnam and only 14% wanted to negotiate a settlement and leave. 1964. Johnson in late summer 1964 seriously questioned the value of staying in Vietnam, but, after meeting with Secretary of State Dean Rusk and Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff Maxwell D. Taylor, declared his readiness to do more when we had a base or when Saigon was politically more stable. In the 1964 presidential campaign, he restated his determination to provide measured support for Vietnam while avoiding another Korea, but privately he had a sense of foreboding about Vietnam, a feeling that no matter what he did, things would end badly indeed. His heart was on his Great Society agenda, and he even felt that his political opponents favored greater intervention in Vietnam in order to divert attention and resources away from his war on poverty. The situation on the ground was aggravated in the fall by additional Viet Minh attacks on U.S. ships in the Tonkin Gulf, as well as an attack on Bien Hoa Airbase in South Vietnam. Johnson decided against retaliatory action at the time after consultation with the Joint Chiefs and also after public pollster Lou Harris confirmed that his decision would not detrimentally affect him at the polls. By the end of 1964, there were approximately 23,000 military personnel in South Vietnam. U.S. casualties for 1964 totaled 1,278 in the winter of 1964-65. Johnson was pressured by the military to begin a bombing campaign to forcefully resist a communist takeover in South Vietnam. Moreover, a plurality in the polls at the time were in favor of military action against the communists, with only 26-30% opposed. Johnson revised his priorities, and a new preference for stronger action came at the end of January with yet another change of government in Saigon, he then agreed with Mac Bundy and McNamara that the continued passive role would only lead to defeat and withdrawal in humiliation. Johnson said, "Stable government or no stable government in Saigon, we will do what we ought to do. I'm prepared to do that. We will move strongly." General Nguyen Khan, head of the new government, is our boy. 1965 Secretary of Defense Robert McNamara and General Westmoreland in Vietnam. 1965 Johnson decided on a systematic bombing campaign in February after a ground report from Bundy recommending immediate U.S. action to avoid defeat. Also, the Viet Cong had just killed 8 U.S. advisors and wounded dozens of others in an attack at Pleiku Air Base. The 8-week bombing campaign became known as Operation Rolling Thunder. Johnson's instructions for public consumption were clear. There was to be no comment that the war effort had been expanded. Long-term estimates of the bombing campaign ranged from an expectation that Hanoi would rein in the Viet Cong to one of provoking Hanoi and the Viet Cong into an intensification of the war, but the short-term expectations were consistent, that the morale and stability of the South Vietnamese government would be bolstered by limiting the information given out to the public and even to Congress. Johnson maximized his flexibility to change course in March. Bundy began to urge the use of ground forces. American air operations alone, he counseled, would not stop Hanoi's aggression against the South. Johnson approved an increase in logistical troops of 18,000 to 20,000, the deployment of 2 additional Marine battalions and a Marine Air Squadron, in addition to planning for the deployment of 2 more divisions, and most importantly a change in mission from defensive to offensive operations. Nevertheless, he disobligingly continued to insist that this was not to be publicly represented as a change in existing policy after a conference of advisors in Honolulu in April 1965. By the middle of June, the total U.S. ground forces in Vietnam were increased to 82,000 or by 150%. On May 2, 1965, Johnson told congressional leaders that he wanted an additional $700 million for Vietnam and the Dominican Republic, saying, "Each member of Congress who supports this request is voting to continue our effort to try to hold communist aggression." The request was approved by the House 408-7 and by the Senate 88-3 in June. Ambassador Taylor reported that the bombing offensive against North Vietnam had been ineffective, and that the South Vietnamese Army was outclassed and in danger of collapse. Gen. Westmoreland shortly thereafter recommended the president further increase ground troops from 82,000 to 175,000 after consulting with his principals. Johnson, desirous of a low profile, chose to announce at a press conference an increase to 125,000 troops, with additional forces to be sent later upon request in order to mute his announcement. Johnson at the same time announced the nomination of Abe Fortas to the Supreme Court and John Chancellor as director of the Voice of America. Johnson described himself at the time as boxed in by unpalatable choices, between sending Americans to die in Vietnam and giving in to the communists. If he sent additional troops, he would be attacked as an interventionist, and if he did not, he thought he risked being impeached. He continued to insist that his decision did not imply any change in policy whatsoever of his desire to veil the decision. Johnson jested privately, "If you have a mother-in-law with only one eye, and she has it in the center of her forehead, you don't keep her in the living room." By October 1965, there were over 200,000 troops deployed in Vietnam. Polls showed that beginning in 1965, the public was consistently 40 to 50. Downplayed the war. He made very few speeches about Vietnam, and held no rallies or parades or advertising campaigns. He feared that publicity would charge up the hawks who wanted victory, and weaken both his containment policy and his higher priorities in domestic issues. Jacobs and Shapiro conclude, although Johnson held a core of support for his position, the president was unable to move Americans who held hawkish and dovish positions. On April 2, 1965, the current Canadian Prime Minister, Lester B. Pearson, gave a speech at Temple University in Philadelphia. During his speech, he voiced his support for a pause in the American bombing of North Vietnam, so that a diplomatic solution to the crisis may unfold to President Johnson. This criticism of American foreign policy on American soil was an intolerable sin. Before Pearson had finished his speech, he was summoned to Camp David, Maryland, to meet with Johnson the next day. Johnson, who was notorious for his personal touch in politics, reportedly grabbed Pearson by the lapels and shouted, "Don't you come into my living room and piss on my rug." 1966 At the end of 1965, after consultation with the Joint Chiefs and other advisors, Johnson decided to increase troops at the rate of 15,000 per month throughout 1966 rather than increasing them at one time, in order to avoid a more publicized increase. At the same time, there was deliberation over a bombing pause, and Johnson finally agreed on December 28 to a pause and a corresponding peace offensive. The pause in bombing and the peace blitz ended January 31 without discernible effect, disturbed by criticism of the war, then underscored with public hearings by the Senate Foreign Relations Committee in January. Johnson convened a second Honolulu conference, and personally attended for 3 days along with Ambassador Lodge, Gen Westmoreland, the Vietnamese Chief of State Nguyen Van Thieu, and Prime Minister Nguyen Sao Ky. In April 1966, Johnson was encouraged by statistics that the Viet Cong had suffered greater numbers of casualties than the South Vietnamese. At the same time, despite urgings in Honolulu to strengthen his internal affairs, Prime Minister Ky's administration was increasingly vulnerable to rebel forces. The administration pressured Ky to hasten a transfer of power to an assembly, but he demurred, awarding a medal to a U.S. soldier during a visit to Vietnam in 1966. Public as well as political impatience with the war began to emerge in the spring of 1966 at the time, when Johnson's approval ratings were reaching new lows of 41%, Sen. Richard Russell, chairman of the Armed Services Committee, reflected the national mood in June 1966, when he declared it was time to get it over or get out. Johnson responded by saying to the press, "We are trying to provide the maximum deterrence that we can to communist aggression with a minimum of cost." In response to the intensified criticism of the war effort, Johnson employed the suspicion of communist subversion in the country, and press relations.